beautiful mushrooms.
Yeah.
This is chestnut. It's a great oyster, this golden oyster. Wild rice. Try the candy cane.
It's one of these. Okay. Yeah, often found in
their
beauty
because
it's really good for your skin.
Good morning. Fungi fair menu. Mushroom
sausage
burger.
Mushroom burger is good.
That's good.
We had the mushroom soup.
Yep.
Mushroom Swiss burger.
This is the demo dish, chicken with the wood, with the biscuit.
It is so cool.
Now, very, very good.
Yeah, it is so cool.
Mushroom soup.
Bought several from
wow, delicious.
Got one that had like,
and that's the mushroom burger. My wife had that one. Do you like it? Chicken on the wood. Do you like your burger?
Yeah.
The biscuits, chicken, the carrots.
Yeah,
this is the chicken or the wood mushroom.
Mushroom pictures of morels successfully growing in an upper Midwest environment outside cultivated. Many say they're fake, many say the kits don't work. I still follow because again it's the same based off the same Chinese research. So this is what he's growing outside. Post pictures like that, you're going to get attention. So again, all these links are in the presentation if you guys want to follow up with Wisconsin Mycological Society. He is one of the first ones that has shown a successful blonde mushroom cultivation, which is very exciting. So that was kind of a high note that I took in interest in him about. So we're going to do the detailed walkthrough now of how to grow morels inside. Easy peasy. All right, so again, go direct to the source, Amazon, morel cultivation, comma, book, bam, there is one. Sure, all in Chinese, I do not speak Mandarin. Order this puppy up, beautiful AI, translate the whole book and do the art of AI. Boop, there we go. The entire book was translated in under 30 minutes, so. Very interesting. Again, come take pictures of the book if you want to get into it. Basically, a step-by-step process of a morel farmer in China. Very, very interesting. Very, very interesting photos as well. So, 14 steps, as I call them. We have site preparation, soil preparation, isolate selection, spawn production, spawn inoculation, spawn consumption, spawn placement, soil covering, tarp removal, spring flooding, extra bags, fruiting, harvesting. So first, number one thing, morels take 1 year to grow. Start in fall, harvest in the spring. So what we are doing right now, it's happening, and you're gonna see it happening right now. So in fall, usually October to November, we're gonna be doing this in November here in Wisconsin once our greenhouses are finished. If we can do this in greenhouses in the Midwest context, we are gonna have a competitive edge against Chinese grown morels and have a seasonal jump and offer an extended morel season for the upper Midwest. And again, a lot of people aren't growing stuff during winter inside greenhouses, and if you grow from October to early April, you're going to have an entire different crop that you've never even had before with the space that you've already had.
As they get older, they will.
Freshly foraged.
Cold weather logs, cold weather strains do not respond to forced fruiting from the soak. They'll take the water from the soak, but they won't force them to make any mushrooms. Some of the cold weather strains need weather like this to wake them up to even get it going. One strain is called Jupiter, and it takes 2 years to get your first mushroom. It's a long wait, but when your mushrooms come, I've seen mushrooms that are bigger around than this plate. It's huge, but they take 3 months to grow sometimes. You gotta play the game with a blanket and a tarp. And if it snows, they can get some snow on them and they can handle temperatures down to 25, 23 degrees for about a week. And if it warms up, they'll continue to grow yet, as long as they don't get dried out by the wind. So having some leaf cover or a tarp loosely over them during those windy times when there's not snow, you can prolong their growing cycle. I felt like a squirrel out there the first couple of years because I had my logs, I had a long 4x4 posts, and I had all my logs laying across from each other, one end up, one end touching the ground in the leaf litter, just so they wouldn't get dried out. So I'd break some leaves over them when I see some, and then a couple weeks later, I must look like a squirrel, I'm digging through the leaves, oh yeah, there's a couple under here. And a lot of times the mushrooms would come up from underneath the log where it's wind protected, where it's a bit warmer, the ground's not frozen yet. Another thing to do, I watered the ground real heavily in this area so that the ground wouldn't freeze quickly. That helped that whole area stay warmer. Then with the tarp over it, you get some sunshine. It warmed the whole area up. You prolonged the season a little bit. But you'd still feel like a squirrel out there digging through your nuts because you know there's someone that's, I saw a little one. Where is it now? Now it's, you know, big enough to pick. So it can be fun. All right. I'm going to get started. Shiitake culture. Learned some Japanese scrolls from, like, 179 AD. And ever since the Chinese and the Japanese have been working with this mushroom, trying to figure out how to make it grow. And they've done a really good job. We've really come a long way. Now we can grow this mushroom in a continental dry climate here. This mushroom's not native to here. It wouldn't grow here on its own without our help. But it's a really delicious mushroom that has a lot of good nutritional values for us. So it's worth
growing. What's it called?
Shiitake.
Oh, shiitake.
Shiitake happens.
Yeah, very good. So, we've got a special drill bit designed by the shiitake industry to make drilling this hole really quick and easy. It has a stop on the bit so we can only drill so deep every time. This is a special adapter made for your angle grinder, standard 4.5-inch angle grinder. It makes this into like a drill on steroids. You can drill holes very quickly. And you do a pattern. I'll show you. I usually start a couple inches from the end. You're about 4 to 6 inches apart down the row. Turn the log a little bit, about an inch away from that row should be your next row. But instead of putting these together, you put the next hole in between where those other two holes are. You make a diamond pattern when you're all done. Heads up, there'll be some. Don't drill your fingers, and be sure to have safety glasses on, which I did do.
How old is the log?
This log was cut just a few weeks ago.
Okay.
After cut last week.
Okay.
Logs should be cut during the dormant season. I have a farmer friend who has some trees that lean out into his hayfield, and they keep banging his equipment when he drives by with a tractor. So he said, could you take those down? I said, sure. Mm-hmm. Normally we cut oak during the dormant season, which is leaf color to leaf drop, all the way until spring till bud swell, which is usually about March, end of March. Mm-hmm. They don't want us to cut oak after that because you're promoting the spread of oak wilt. Mm-hmm. Those little picnic beetles, those little brown, black and yellow little bugs, they like to go where the sap's running, and they'll go from one wound on a tree to another wound on the tree and spread it around that way. I also wonder, I haven't heard anybody say or confirm this, but I suspect that your yellow-bellied sapsucker that pecks holes in the bark and sucks the sap, that may also be a point of sap ooze that could maybe spread oak wilt to another tree. But they only tend to usually pound on red oaks more than, because the bark is thinner. Mm-hmm. I do sometimes see that on fir oak or white oak, but it's usually way up in the tree where the bark's not real thick yet. And that's usually what the bird's way up there. You hear that?
Yeah.
Look around, there's the yellow-bellied sapsucker up there, running on the boards. Alright. So, when you drill your holes, for handling the dowels, have your hands clean. I washed my hands just a few minutes ago. If you're handling a bunch of logs, your hands are dirty, wash your hands before you do this. If you change to a different strain of shiitake, again, wash your hands, clean the hammer off. One strain of shiitake and a different strain of shiitake in the same log, they're gonna fight to the death. Even though they're cousins, they don't like each other. So stick with the same strain per log. Now you can have different logs of different strains next to each other, but you can't put different kinds of dowels in the same log because they're going to fight for dominance here. And they'll spend all their energy trying to push somebody out, and you're not going to get as many mushrooms, if any at all. These little bits of grain spawn that are in here, if some of these fall in the hole before you put a dowel in, it's not going to hurt. It's going to be to your advantage. Although it's time consuming and a pain in the butt to put a little kernel in every time, but sometimes there's some stuck on your hand and you can just knock them off in there. Found them in flush. If they don't go in all the way, it's because the guy didn't drill a hole deep enough. You don't need a big hammer. You don't just swing real hard because you're going to damage the bark hitting too hard. Some people use a mallet or a... But then there's the matter of sealing the inoculation point with wax, which is really important. You can't skip that process. talk about that in a second here. Let me get glass dolls in. There's two kinds of wax you can use. One is called cheese wax. It comes in a hard form and you have to heat it up to melt it. The other form is called plug wax. It's cheese wax with mineral oil mixed into it, so it's like a real hard Vaseline. And this you can just use your back of your fingernail or thumbnail to scrape a little up, put it over the hole, and smear it on with your thumb. It takes a little longer than the hot wax, but you don't have to mess around with a crock pot or a stove to heat up that wax. Wax does catch on fire, so I try not to use it. I know some guys use propane little camp stoves and heat it up in a frying pan. Just let that be. It's probably contaminated now. If one falls on the ground, on the dirt, leave it. Now there's another type of spawn. It comes in sawdust form. And you have to have a special plunger tool to jab into your bowl of sawdust spawn. Fill the tool up, then transfer it over the hole. Hit the paddle, tap it into the hole. It works really well because you're drilling a bigger hole. It's almost half inch diameter, so more of the fibers going north and south in the sap with the xylem and phloem tubes are being interrupted, and it's an easy avenue for the mycelium to go right up those tubes. You got a bigger hole, so it grows a wide stripe quicker. They say with those you can have your rows spaced further apart. You can also have your holes further apart. Anytime you put your holes further apart or your rows further apart, it's going to take longer for this to compensate and fill it up. I like to lean towards having a few more holes tighter together and have my rows tighter together. Then I'm more confident that I'm not going to have problems with wind or dryness, and I have a better chance for success. Maybe I'll only get 18 logs out of this bag of spawn and maybe 20 logs, but I'd rather have 18 good logs and have one log that's kind of sitting there enjoying other mushrooms and not performing as well as it could. I normally, for my own growing reasons, I usually do, if I have a chance to cut the tree up myself, I like to cut my branches about 40 inches in length. They just fit in my stock tank. They're easy enough to grab by both ends and carry them around and move them. And I prefer logs about that diameter so I can pick them up and carry them easily. If I use bigger logs than that, big fat honk, I will use trunk pieces, bigger pieces, but I'll install the cold weather strains of shiitake that don't respond to that putting in a tank and soaking. They can just lay there. They can lay there forever until they're done. They'll make mushrooms for 8-9 years just laying there stacked up. You can have some logs stacked onto them, you know, so that they're all together and you water them all at the same time. Cold weather strains are a whole different animal of shiitake. They take longer to grow. They make a superior quality mushroom because they take longer to grow. It's usually a lot thicker and denser. Alright, let's see if I can do this. We'll do this with plug wax. Got some hot wax heated up too. I use a deep fryer with some cans with an empty pineapple can inside of it. With the wax in the can, the heat from the oil transfers through the can, melts the wax. I use a pliers to pick it out of there, put it in the big coffee cup and come over. I have a special tool that applies that hot wax. It's really slick, but it's not cheap. That special tool costs $200. And it's a unitasker. It's only good for one thing. You're never going to use it for anything else. But if you're just doing a few logs, doing this is much cheaper. If you think you're gonna start doing 100, 150 logs, buy the cheese wax and go to the secondhand store and find a little fry daddy and do the can thing in there. It'll work really well. Or you can use a crock pot. I've seen people do crock pot. The problem with crock pot this time of the year, you take the cover off and now the wax gets too cool and it's starting to cloud up and it doesn't want to spread on or seal the hole as well. Hot wax actually cauterizes the surface, sterilizes any chunk around that hole. That's another reason that the hot wax has its advantages. Plus you don't get it all over your finger like this. When I first started doing this, I thought I was really knocking it out of the park when I did 20 logs in one day with the old-fashioned Black & Decker corded drill, pounding the doubles in and smearing this wax on by hand. With the modern tools, with the grinder, and with the hot wax, I can do 20 logs in about 6 hours by myself. Drilling, filling, waxing, labeling, and taking them out to the yard. Having a little table with some wheels on it sure does help. And I'll tell you right now, having that hot wax is a lot quicker than this. But this is cheap and it works, and you don't have to buy anything. You know, if you're not sure you want to do this, you probably wouldn't want to buy the hot wax if you have to melt and all that. Unless you really, you know, if you like this and want to do it, I certainly think it's worth doing. Thank you for the sun coming out. My gosh, it did not look very good before. When I was on my way out to this neck of the woods yesterday, I spent the night in Caledonia. Boy, it fucking rained. Thunder and lightning. Oh boy. Even some hail, I think. Good thing it wasn't yesterday, because I would not have been out here. I had to cover up the deep fryer. I didn't want any rain going in the deep fryer, because you know what that's like when someone throws an ice cube in the deep fryer. Oh boy.
Can you only use fresh logs, or can you use like year old, or
they have to be like recently fresh. Cut fresh live? Yeah, you can use storm damage in the summertime if you get some, but you better not wait too long, because others in the summertime there's so many spores flying around and everything's looking to grow into something. If you wait a couple of weeks, one in the summertime, the logs don't have as much moisture or nutrients in them as they would in the wintertime. See, in the dormant season, when the leaves turn colors, that means the tree's bringing nutrients back to store in the upper limbwood. Mm-hmm. They want to store it there for springtime when the bud swell comes. It's all the nutrients are right there close to making leaves again. Mm-hmm. So,
and then you would do this in the wintertime then?
Yeah.
Normally, okay.
Yeah, we'd normally cut in the wintertime and then inoculate early spring. As soon as you can handle being outside working in the weather, March.
Yeah.
If you've got a garage you can work in, you could inoculate in February. Put your logs outside. It's not going to freeze hard enough to kill these. I would say in January, maybe you wouldn't want to inoculate and put them outside. Even if you inoculate in January, keep them in your garage for a month, then put them out.
Okay.
The way our winters have been lately, it's not all that bitter cold. I think you'd be safe with them.
And then what's the care for them after that, once they're plugged and filled?
Kind of treat it like your garden. If we don't get any rain in a week, they should receive an inch of rain a week.
Okay.
So if it doesn't rain, put a sprinkler on them that night for a couple hours.
Should be
shade.
Awesome.
It really doesn't like sun. Indirect sunlight, I put in the shade, if you can understand what I'm saying there. Direct sunlight's gonna burn, direct sunlight will sunburn the bark, especially this red oak with the smoother bark. It can't handle direct sunlight for very long. It's gonna dry out and it's gonna start to peel. I've got some of the small pieces of red oak. I'll show you one that, what the sun does to the bark. You start to see the bark peeling back. Red oak has such thin bark, and that's taken some life off the lawn. But that's why some people avoid using red oak, because of this problem. This one's got a little too much wind and maybe a little too much sun in the bush before I had it getting fun. These white marks adjacent to where the storm bugs were, it's going to make some up there.
Will probably last for
3 years, for 2 years, for sure, instead of 4 or 5 years. Like, the white oak has a stiffer bark there, or longevity of the weather's better. The white oak family, black white oak, and pearl oak are all in the same white oak family. The bark is tougher and more weather resistant. Can handle being bumped and bruised more. This thin bark, if you bang the logs together, now you got a nick there. And that's a chance for other mushrooms to go into that spot where moisture escapes. So when you're inoculating these logs, anytime you cut with a chainsaw or nick something, where you cut a branch off, these spots should be waxed over. Not the ends, because the logs need to breathe enough to be able to resource it from the end. Any dead branch stuff that was cut off should be waxed too. Because this, the grain on this goes right into the heart of this log. If you ever cut a log in half and saw the way the wood grain goes, this little branch stuff, there's a core to this that goes right down to the heartwood of it on the inside. So that's a quick avenue for other contaminants to get deep into the log. We don't want that. Yes, there are some. Shiitake prefers to be on oak. You can use popcorn beam or ironwood, but it has even a more drying out quick problem because the bark is so thin. If you can manage the moisture on it, it'll do pretty good. It won't last as long as oak. Blue beech blue beech. There's a tree called blue beech. There's another name for it too. It grows in marshy, swampy land more often. It doesn't get real big. It's a member of the musselwood family. It's a member of the hop hornbeam family. I have a friend who has a farm in Milford who has swampy land. He has a bunch of blue beech there. He's been doing it on blue beech. They work really good, but they have that problem. The bark is thin. They dry out kind of quick. And they only make mushrooms for 2 or 3 years. They make a bunch of mushrooms, and they're done in 3 years. He doesn't keep any of his. He does this for a part-time living. He only keeps his logs for 3 years in production because he forces them twice a year. Then he gives them away or sells them cheap because he's always, every year you add another 100 logs to your garden or your farm, or 200 logs. I was to the point where I was doing 150 logs a year, and I had 4 years in a row of 150 logs in my yard, and then I got tapped to being a primary caregiver to my sister, so I kind of put the kibosh on doing a mushroom thing. I was still working at a factory too at the same time, so I was like, okay, this is just going to be a hobby. That's all I can manage to do. Now sister's in a better place, and they're taking care of her. I got more time. I'm going to try to ramp it back up again. But I've got all these old dead logs in my yard that aren't going to make any more mushrooms, and I need to get them cleared out so I got room for more. So
and typically, how many years does your logs last for?
If you don't force them, you let them just do things naturally. Mm-hmm. You could probably get 4 to 5 years. Maybe six, if you're using the big cold weather logs that are big and heavy, they might last 7 years.
Nice.
Okay. These little short ones that you're gonna force through, 3 good years, fourth year not so good. By the fifth year, the bark's falling off in a lot of places, okay, and you're better off giving away. Yes, question.
So, were you talking about the frost killing off only in the mycelium stage, and then after that you can keep them outside? For like
the
winter?
What used to be the problem is why most people didn't inoculate in the fall or late in the fall is because we get hard cold winters. Before these actually get to grow into the log and start colonizing, it could get cold enough to maybe stop that whole process from happening, and then it has to start up again in spring if there's any life left to it. Mm-hmm. And if it's exposed to the wind and the sun during that time, it's not going to be very happy. So that's why cover them in leaves, have them in the shade, under some bushes somewhere. You don't want them buried so much that they can't get rainfall, mm-hmm. Otherwise you'll have to water them. You tuck them under a pine tree that's got so many branches it doesn't get even wet unless you get an inch of rain. That's putting in a dry spot too. But the same thing, near a pine tree, pine trees acidify the soil. Any mushroom that grows around a pine tree is not looking for a piece of oak. Only mushrooms that can live around a pine tree are ones that are used to that acidy pine thing. So it's kind of a clean place to put your log for the first year, as long as you can get enough rain on it and not have sunshine on it.
Okay. You can leave them out through the winter then?
Yes, you can.
So you just cover them with leaves then? Or
yep, I would.
Do you have to water them in the winter?
If it snows, throw snow on them.
Okay.
Bury them in snow.
Okay.
In spring, remember to take those leaves off. You know, if we get a lot of snow, you can maybe swipe some of the leaves away and just bury them in the snow.
But other than a little snow, you don't really have to maintenance them in the winter?
No.
Okay, thank you.
You can let these lay and kind of forget about until spring. I say by May, take a look at them and see what's going on, maybe readjust them. They shouldn't be touching the ground. They always say don't let them touch the ground. Ground has all kinds of dirt, has other spores in it.
Even after they're plugged?
Yeah, dirt.
I just bought two and laid them on the ground in my yard.
It's okay. It's okay. You have time to move them yet.
Yeah.
I'm going to expound on that.
Okay, sorry. I got a couple minutes late, too.
Everyone says don't have them touch the ground. Well, I tell you what. Most of my logs are up on a 2x4 or a 4x4 and one end is touching the ground. Every time I have them up on pallets, people say, put them on pallets. There's so much airflow through a pallet, you've got to water them extra because there's so much airflow. I want this to be less work, but still have success. So I found that having them on a rail like that, one that way, one this way, one this way, one that way, just so there's an inch or two of space between those log butt ends, so there's a little bit of airflow, has worked out well. Then you get those mushrooms during dry times. You won't get any mushrooms on top, but they'll grow from underneath. That's where the wind can't sweep under there and get all the humidity away. So even in dry on top, it stays more humid down there. And the higher up you have your log stacks, the much drier it's going to be. So keeping your stack lower to the ground, I never go more than, I do some Lincoln log stacks, but I never go more than maybe 3 high, because you get into that wind problem.
So do you prefer, does it matter, plugs on top or underneath? I suppose they're going to be
They're going to be all around. Okay. It doesn't really matter. I'm going to get the hot wax right now so I can finish these points up and then I'll drill this. The benefits of having some kind of a crock pot, it has its own advantages, so it's never going to overheat the wax for us. I'll let my wax go on hot so that I can see that it sizzles and sort of sterilizes the surface, and it also penetrates the wood. The wax isn't very hot, it's not going to penetrate into the wood, and it can get bumped off or scraped off later when you're handling your logs. This special tool was designed by the shiitake industry in Japan just for this purpose. It's all stainless steel. It has a good amount of mass to this head, so it holds this temperature in cold, windy weather like today. Most people are doing their inoculations in early spring, March, April. Wax cools down pretty quickly on a cold day. So this actually keeps the thing, and the sponge tip allows the wax to flow through just a little bit, so it's like, just touch it and the wax goes on. And it's cool on the cold side. The tip, I had the tool out of in the cool breeze for a while. But this little tool really is a time saver, but it's also expensive. This was $200 for this tool. It's a unitasker. You're only going to use it for this.
Yeah.
So but do you have to do anything special when you're done to clean it?
No. Just punch the sponge out, or if the sponge isn't damaged or worn down, you can use the sponge. It comes with like a lifetime supply of sponges with it, so I guess that's it's some consolation. And all right, we'll drill this one up now.
Anyway, Tavis is our speaker for today. He also has created the Wisconsin Mushroom Certification Class with our club, and then like a bunch of other really amazing things. So we're really lucky to have him both on the board and here today to tell us about mushrooms, because he is pretty much the premier knowledgeable person in Wisconsin about mushrooms. Like, there's nobody that's gonna know more than this guy. So we're really lucky to have him. Give him a round of applause. Woo!
My name is Tavis. As you said, you forgot to say I'm the vice president of the WSU.
I'm sorry.
Oh,
yeah. Well, for about 2 more months.
Right. Today we're going to talk about intimidating mushroom genera.
Mr. G.
That's things that we have problems with at our 4-H, trying to nail down the species. There's a lot of genera that can be difficult. So we've been working, especially myself and Brennan, help from Marissa here. Trying to nail these genera down. You can probably guess what they are. What do you think?
The Cordinarius?
Cordinarius, there's one. Cordinarius, yeah. We got a better handle on those. Entoloma, Cordinarius, Inosity, Foliota, and then by request of our president, we wanted something on the Goldberg. Fine, we'll be here. We're going to have Plutius too, but I think I'm going to skip that thing. So these are genera that we run into problems with when we're trying to build our species list. We have a species list for every event that the WMS does, and we want them as happy as possible. We're doing a species list from today. So our cable foray is early September. It stands right now at 447 species came in 2 days. I've only seen 400 grow 4 times. I've been doing this for 42 years.
Whoa.
I've seen 500 broken once, 502 in 2017. So to break 400 is awesome. But we've probably seen 400 species a lot of other times, but we couldn't assign names to them. You know, we're still learning. Mycology is a constantly growing field. So we would have things like Cordinarius species, Northwoods, Dash, Dursley, one time, you'll know what I'm asking. These are details we have to pay attention to. These are things that help. And the little variables, just in the state of Wisconsin, we have probably over 30 species. I've got 19 of them now, maybe. And we know what they are. We've actively identified 19 species. That's excellent, because before we could identify, must be all of them that I can. Some of them had to come out. So we're going to look at some pseudosperma and some hymospermia. They don't have any pictures of immunosity, but I know all of them have those clay brown spores, but the spore shape can vary greatly. They are often with encrusted capitate fluorescence in them. I'll show you what that means in a minute here. It actually makes more sense than it's less confusing than it sounds. And many have gone unidentified. It's an inosity. Throw it in the inosity pile. We can do better than that. It's just trying to figure out what to look for. One that popped up last year was very confusing, but we did get it. I found it in June or July in my neighborhood. It's a large inosity, Inosity celebracea. The only place I could find it published was in the old Roger Phillips book. But it was cool, but we put it under the microscope. No, it's not. It's not. It was either Tyquemininensis or Calamistrata, whichever was Calamistrata. Pseudosperma. This is one of the reasons that all the old field guides say don't eat little brown mushrooms. This baby is beastly poisonous. It is a small, fragile mushroom. These are only less than 2 inches tall. You know, the caps are just a little bit bigger than a quarter. And we can see a lot of these fibrils on the cap. We're seeing the caps hurting. The spinosolium, you know, already you have copernellus. Copernopsis atramentaria. What do we know about that mushroom?
Tippler's Bane.
No beer. You eat this mushroom. I eat this mushroom. It's got a kind of interesting rutabaga-like taste. No, it's not bad. But then you can't drink any alcohol for 3 days. It stops your liver's ability to process ethanol. So a couple women will tell Copyright Institute, I think it's been 4 or 5 years ago now, they ate this mushroom and then drank a teaspoon of wine and got hammered. So you imagine what it would feel like to drink a whole glass of wine, you know, a six pack of water watching the Packers game or something. You're going to get sick, you're not going to like it. And this is also a species complex, whatever. The deforestation process is starting to turn into an ancient disaster. Very pretty one. Copernopsis variegata, more common in the spring. Here we can see that universal veil is starting to shed. The mushroom is expanding, it's outgrowing it. Soon we're starting to see holes pop in it. We're going to start to see those flocculous scales on the cap as that mushroom matures. Here we can see what those scales look like at maturity. This is Copernopsis promagnesiana. Less common in Wisconsin than this year. I just took this picture in Osceola, Wisconsin, 2 weeks ago. Last week, 2 weeks ago today, actually. But we can see those scaly patches. Parasola. So this one doesn't bend the west quite as much. It always kind of holds its shape. But this is one of the hardest mushrooms to get a photo of, because they are insanely delicate. As most copernicians are a little bit fragile, this one is beyond fragile. This thing is, the stems bend over, so I picked these and 2 minutes later I was taking pictures and they were already junk. Screwdriver Jim had to help me. And of course, the most famous of them all, and the copernicians, which is absolutely not related to any of the other copernicians, Copernicus coronatus, or what do we call it? Yes, the lawyer's wig. Or the shaggy head. Or the shaggy head cap. I like these. It's a good mushroom. This mushroom should be popping up here anytime. This is a late season mushroom. So the point of the whole deal is details, right? You gotta think outside the mushroom. Pay attention to habitat. This is my third year in a row, or fourth year in a row, third, I think. At Funny Fair giving a talk, and I've said the same thing every time. Pay attention to what's around the mushroom that you picked. I say it in the woods. I've used this story before. It was a guy in the Heidelberg 10 years ago. He found a mushroom. I don't even remember what it was. And I said, what kind of trees were around? And he said, well, they're working. I thought that was really neat that he was in the middle of the national forest and there were no trees around. There was trees around. Pay attention. Was it growing in the oak? Was it growing in the hemlocks? Was it in the pines? Or was it at least get close or be able to take somebody back there to help me out? Yeah. So pay attention to the habitat. Smell the mushroom. I forget to do that sometimes. Mariah is really good at it. She picks up a mushroom and smells it before she looks at it. That's important. Get a chemical kit. Throw in a couple bucks. They last a long time. I mean, you only use one drop of KOH at a time. I got 3 little 1-ounce bottles at home I've had for 3 or 4 years. They do expire, you do have to remake them a couple of years ago. I invested in a microscope. I really like my microscope. I only paid, I think it was like $400. And I got the whole camera kit on the top, the whole work, and scope. They work just fine. Unless you want to take really wildly cool pictures with it, any cheap microscope will work, just make sure you can zoom into 1,000. And do your best to get beyond genus level. That's something that we've been working on, especially Brennan and myself, when we're doing these species lists, and Brad Knowles too, and Jeremy Holmstead. We're getting better at it. The four of us are getting better, but that helps everybody else get better too. Because it's not just our job, it's everyone in here. When we're on a 4A, we want all the information that you can give us. You're helping us, you're working too. And then I said we had 449 species that. Everybody started clapping. That's exciting. That's exciting for everyone that's there. Those are huge numbers. I don't think we had a furry this year that was under 200. You know, if you don't hit 200, you're kind of wasting your time. We had a couple break 300, but the break 400 is a pretty magical number. The thing of it is, all these years, we probably have been breaking 400. We've been pinching mushrooms. We didn't have a title for them. So we're getting better at this. There's lots of good resources out there. I've got a flash drive, or not a flash drive, I've got an external hard drive on my computer. It's full of nothing but papers and books that people sent me. If anybody wants any of that ever, let me know. I'm not hoarding it in public knowledge. So that is what I got. I will be happy to take a couple of questions if you want. Marissa was up a half an hour.
Well, yeah, so this is super helpful, and this is the sort of thing that I would want to be able to spend time learning about outside of the 4As, but it's hard to kind of do the homework or whatever and learn about these different more difficult species because A, the names are always changing, and so I don't know where to find like up-to-date information, and two, besides like reading a field guide, like are there resources you would recommend for kind of more holistic information, like generalized information like this that helps you get familiar with categories and stuff?
Sure. So as far as the names go, index hunger. .org, you type that in, then you see this library, you type in whatever your epithet is, then you go over and select epithet, genus, author, or high bunch of class. It's index hunger. Yeah, so if you type in, like we had up there today, we had Calamus ratum, the Hymenus firm. If you typed in Calamus ratum, and click epithet and hit search, it would give you every mushroom that's ever had that name in blue. And off to the right, there's an update to the name and I have it in green.
Okay.
And it'll give you the whole history of that name, and that's updated continually.
Okay, so
Naturalist doesn't keep up, and sometimes they change things that shouldn't have changed.
The other thing is, everybody has different opinions on those names too. On the leading edge of science, you're like 5 out of 10 mycologists disagree.
Yeah, for sure.
The rest of them disagree too.
So you still treat a lot of those names as synonyms.
Yeah.
So if you called it Inosity calamistrata, I accept that. Inosperma calamistratum is the current moment accepted. But that name is gone. You know, it's still a synonym to the valid name. So, and the idea is that eventually we're not changing names anymore. That's the ultimate goal, obviously. But some things were so misplaced. You know, like Coprinus and those other two being all in Coprinus, when they're not even in the same family, they're not even genetically related back home. They're quite distantly related.
Right.
We have to separate them. So, yes, sir.
Is there more use of AI technology or the
I'm sure that there could be, but all the apps that I've seen are terrible.
They're really bad.
They're really bad.
I mean, there's
good ones for plants.
It's dangerous. They
won't. It's dangerous.
Eventually, maybe it'll get better. But right now, there are things that are, you know, being identified
as overnoying
or out in need of, like, poisoning
somebody.
So it's not good.
Probably the best one for a quick response is plug your photograph into iNaturalist. And they'll give you a pretty fair suggestion. A lot of times they're spot on. Most of the time they're right. But they'll also, you know, that's what's behind it. But they'll say, we're not 100% sure, but it's probably in this genus or something like that. They'll offer you suggestions. Then you do a little bit of your own research. If you want an accurate name and you don't mind waiting 6 months, then plug it into Mushroom Observer. It just doesn't have the human traffic on it, and it doesn't have any AI to suggest what you have. You just put it out there and let the community look at your picture.
But like some resources online, like Facebook groups, like Mushroom Identification, generally speaking, like you'll get sometimes you'll get different opinions, but there are experts in those groups, and you will eventually get a correct consensus when it comes to Mushroom Identification.
Definitely so.
If your pictures are good.
Yeah.
Yeah. And take good pictures. Take your time to take a reasonable photograph. You know, like you know, the blurry one. Those keys are incredible, but the last time that book was updated was 1986. So a lot of things have changed. You know, and some changes aren't necessary, but some certainly are. So I try to keep up to date the best I can, but holy crap, since I got here today, four mushrooms changed names.
Okay, any last questions before we wrap up? I'm going to ask everyone to just stay here for like 2 seconds, and I'm just going to give you my final spiel on this. Looks like Mariah has a question.
Yeah,
Steve,
as you said, people could contact you. Do you want to just share how you most want to?
Yeah, that was supposed to be the last slide. I could bring that up along here really fast.
They could get the presentation, the pictures.
Yeah.
While we're waiting for him to figure out his life, I just wanted to say one last thank you to every single person who came here, especially vendors and the WMS board members that participate and make this whole thing happen every year. Thank you, every single one of you. You guys work so hard, and I'm so proud of every single person on the board. So thanks. Go ahead, Peter.